Suppose, by some magic, we could reverse all accidents. Unfortunately, there is no such magic. One by one, our accident toll mounts up. And with the passage of just one average year, we record an economic loss of at least $9,100,000,000. 9,500,000 injuries. 95,000 deaths from accidental causes. Just one year. But these are figures, symbols, statistics. Who are these 95,000 people anyway? What were they like?
Hello? Mrs. Brooks, it's for you.
Hello? Oh, hello, dear. Oh, it was sweet of you to call. Well, yes, of course, it is quite an honor, and we're all terribly proud. We think he'll be here any minute. He's driving, you know. The North? Oh, that's his gang. They're giving a surprise party for him. Oh, Phil planned it. You know Phil. Phil Hall, his best friend. Oh, yes, he's back.
He's here. He's here. Everybody, hey.
Oh, dear. Just a moment. I think that's him. I'll call you back, all right? Father.
Just check it now.
Mr. Brooks?
Larry.
Yes, officer. What is it? Could I talk to you and your wife alone? It's about your boy.
There'd been an accident. Larry Brooks had been killed. Make any sense. Wonderful guy like Larry, dead. And why? Where could you find the answer? It wasn't even his fault, as we found out the next day at the police station. It was one of those accidents with so many things to blame that it just couldn't be pinned down to any one cause. One thing to blame, except public indifference? Not even that, because people aren't indifferent about things like this. Larry's mother and father certainly weren't indifferent.
Mother. Can't you sleep?
And his friends weren't indifferent. We tried to figure out what we could do.
Of course, if those kids, whoever they were in that jalopy, hadn't cut in front of
them. We've been over this a dozen times already, and where do we always end up? It was everybody's fault and nobody's. Now take that bad shoulder. If the road had been in decent shape.
Phil, Helen's got a good point about that jalopy. We got plenty of crazy drivers right here at West High.
Maybe we ought to start at home base, at school. Let's see the principal first thing in the morning.
All right, Phil, I agree. Something should be done. What do you suggest?
Gee, I don't know, Mr. Redkay.
Well, fortunately, we don't have to start from scratch. There's a good deal of experience we can draw on. You know, Phil, back in the early part of this century, in the early 1900s, accidents were really killing people off in our country. But here and there, people were turning up with constructive ideas. You could call them safety pioneers.
All right. Turn it on, Ed.
These safety pioneers didn't want patents on their inventions. They wanted to spread them far and wide. In 1912, they decided to call a meeting to get together and trade information. That was the first National Safety Congress, and it was worthwhile. In 1913, the National Safety Council was established, a permanent council to help anyone who wanted to join the fight to put an end to maiming and slaughter. And as time went on, the council became the focal point, the spearhead of all organizations and citizens interested in safety. Industries of all kinds, both management and workers. Highway safety groups made up of public officials and private citizens. Insurance companies. Health and welfare organizations, both government and private. Farm organizations and the various youth groups concerned with farm safety. Service clubs of many kinds. Educators, and many, many other groups. And in recognition of its service to the American people, on its 40th anniversary, the National Safety Council was awarded a federal charter by the Congress of the United States. So you see, Phil, there is a national organization we can turn to when we need help on safety problems. Just as we turn to the Red Cross, for instance, in time of disaster.
Well, I see, Mr. Redkay.
So, I'd suggest you write them. See what they've got to say. I'm sure the school will go along with it.
Well, we wrote the National Safety Council. And they came back at us with a lot of good ideas on what other youth groups are doing about safety. And out of all these ideas, we came up with a really good one. Our idea, a teenage safety council and a driver education course in our high school. But even a terrific idea takes a campaign to put it over. We put the staff of our school paper to work pouring out publicity copy. Our fast talkers tackled the local publishers. They were only too glad to cooperate in a big way. A lot of the work was done by PTA members, on the phone. And with house-to-house, door-to-door canvassing, selling our idea of saving lives through driver education. All these things began to add up, especially when we put on a parade. Formal opening drew a big turnout, and nobody was disappointed because we staged quite a show. We had the school's best drivers put on a demonstration of driving skills in automobiles donated to the school by local people who wanted to help. The same cars we'll use in our driver training classes. All in all, it was a big day. And of course, there had to be speeches. What the mayor had to say was pretty important.
And while there is no bronze tablet here to record it, what we have just seen is in effect a memorial to a graduate of this school, Larry Brooks. A boy of great promise, for whose death, I'm afraid, each one of us is a little to blame. For it has been rightly said that accidents don't just happen, nor does safety just happen. Safety must be planned for and worked for.
Well, I guess we'd planned and worked for safety, but things didn't stop with our high school. There was plenty of action from all the townspeople. Ask anybody around here today.
Yes, that's true. We did get action in a lot of ways. And these youngsters showed us the way. I'm superintendent of a large machine shop here in town.
In an industry like ours, you've got a lot of reminders about the everyday importance of safety. But one of the things which stands out in my mind was the case of Ed Adams. Ed was a fine fellow. And he was a top-notch worker, one of our most valuable. He was going places in our shop until one day...
My eyes! My eyes!
He left the hospital, but he was blind, completely sightless, a man whose livelihood depended on his eyes. Of course, he had workman's compensation. That was something. But to a man like Ed, there's no compensation for feeling useless, unwanted, unproductive. We were to find that out. Somehow or other, nobody knows how, not even his wife. Ed got into the shop after hours.
Hey, Ed. What are you doing here?
Hi, Charlie. I just came to see if... to see if... Charlie, take me home!
Okay, Ed. Okay. Come on.
Well, that happened just about the time the high school youngsters started their safety campaign. They asked me to come over and talk to them about industrial safety. And in selling them on the idea, an idea came to me. I sent Hank Bradley, one of our best men, to Chicago to take the National Safety Council's training course on industrial safety. And while he was up there, Hank got a healthy slant on preventing costly accidents. He saw that over the years, since the council has been leading the way, the accident rate has been steadily going down. Well, what Hank learned through the course he took, he liked. And when Hank likes something, he puts it into action. He came back full of ideas which really began to add up in our shop. Tagging off and locking the main switch on a machine to make sure that no one starts it up while you're making an adjustment. Getting our women workers not only to wear safety caps, but to wear them correctly. And here's something that a while back might have meant a tragic and costly accident. But no more. From the word go, we're safety conscious. So you see, this high school safety campaign has meant a lot to our town. If you don't want to take my word, ask somebody else.
Me, for instance. I've got a farm out here on Highway 60. My son was on the committee when these youngsters organized this business. His talking about safety every night got me to thinking about it. Reminded me of Jack Walsh, a fellow I went to school with. There was no better farmer in the whole county than Jack. He knew more about erosion control, contour plowing, and crop rotation than the Secretary of Agriculture. He was a farmer's farmer, except for one thing.
your attention, if you please. We got a very fine farm here. In first-class condition. 260 acres of the finest crop land in the entire state. I think most of you know why it's for sale. And I think most of you know that any land that Jack Walsh ever farmed is bound to be better land than when he took over. That's the kind of farmer he was, the very best. I don't have to tell you how valuable this property is.
There was nothing else Jack could have done. He couldn't find anybody to run his farm and didn't have a son old enough to take it over. Well, as I said, these youngsters' work got me to thinking. So, along with some of my neighbors, I organized a farm safety committee. But don't get me wrong, what they started hasn't ended with us. Talk to Mrs. Morris here, for instance.
Yes, I must say their enthusiasm reached us too, the mothers and wives of our town. We often hear about the lives lost in accidents, and these are terrible, certainly, but just as tragic is the heartbreak and suffering families and friends go through.
Popcorn, peanuts, anyone?
I'm reminded of a dear friend of mine, Nora Carlin. Nora was such a sweet girl and such fun. She and her husband were the center of their group of young people, a crowd that loved to dance and swim and ride. They had a very nice home just outside of town and two lovely children.
I say you give the loveliest parties, Mrs. Carlin.
That's because you're such a wonderful host, Mr. Carlin.
Oh, thank you.
And then one day, something terrible happened to Nora. Its cause was one of those simple, so very simple things. But the heartbreak and suffering it brought to Nora and her husband was something which only someone who has gone through it can know. Of course, everyone tried to help. But sometimes that's about all you can do. Try to help.
Remember the summer we all went riding at Point Pleasant? That was such fun.
Yes, it was such fun, wasn't it? Such fun. Such fun to ride, swim, dance.
Nora, doll, Dan didn't mean anything.
Of course not. Nobody means anything ever. You all say, Nora's so brave. She's holding up so well. And Jim, he's so wonderful. We must all try to make believe it didn't happen. Well, it did happen. It did happen. Can't you understand? And I'm not brave. I'm not brave at all.
Nora, honey, please don't.
I can't help it, Jim. I just can't help it.
Nora will have to come to terms with her misfortune, of course. But in the meantime, every last one of her friends asks, why did it have to happen? And we decided to do something about it. But not just about safety in the home. We knew the job was much bigger than that, and that we were not alone in our concern over it.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I assume we all know why we're here. We're here to let ourselves in for a lot of hard work. But we're here with one thought in mind. You can't departmentalize safety. You can't cut it up into little pieces and expect to get anywhere. Well, the answer, and I think you'll all agree on this, is to get together. We've got to pool our efforts. Make this safety business a community-wide effort. Now, to do this, we've got to have a safety council in our town, representing industry, business, schools, the police department, and what have you. Representing, in short, everybody. Now, I was remembering, before you people arrived this afternoon, what all this fuss is about. That boy there.
Listen to that, would you? And the mayor's right. Only I don't deserve the credit. Larry is the one who deserves the credit. He's not around to take it. I wonder what he'd have to say if he were. Are you kidding, Phil? You know what I'd say. Anybody who doesn't believe in good safety practices all down the line is just plain stupid.
I'll agree. And I've got something more to say. Being on the safe side may take a bit more thought and trouble, but it's worth it. Believe me, it's worth it.
Sometimes you feel as though you don't want to live. But you get over that. What you don't get over is the idea you know most people have, because you had it once too. It won't happen to me. It'll be someone else. But the truth is, it may be you. Anyone at all might be in my place right now. Anyone at all. Anyone at all.